Hey everyone, Jason here, digital marketing consultant, and in this ultimate beginner's guide for Google Analytics, you're going to learn everything you need to know to get up and running with Google Analytics, and most importantly, what reports to focus on when you're just getting started, because there's so many features and reports, so we're gonna 80-20 focus in on what's going to make the biggest impact as you get used to using analytics. Of course, these reports will help you optimize your site and optimize your content and traffic campaigns if you're doing any paid traffic campaigns. So timestamp table of contents in the description because this is going to be a long one. Easily skip around, or if you're coming back to this while you're configuring your own analytics, those links are there for you, along with some other helpful videos that actually take a deep dive into how to use something called Google Tag Manager, which I'll get to in a little bit here, and also set up your Google, Facebook, and YouTube ads if you're going to be doing any sort of paid advertising. So with that, before we dive in to the five simple steps to getting up and running with Google Analytics, there's one big warning that we need to address before we jump in, and that is Google Analytics is not retroactive. So if Google Analytics isn't on your site, obviously there's no way to get the data that it wasn't on the site before. And if you have not clicked some things inside of your analytics account, then it's not collecting data. So essentially, you want to think of analytics as a factory or processor of your traffic information. And you'll see when we get to configurations why this is so important. But essentially, all your traffic comes in, Google Analytics does what you ask it to, and then it spits out some data. But it doesn't necessarily, if you don't do anything, it won't collect all the traffic information that's coming in. Kind of strange, I know, but we'll make sure that all the traffic information is being collected and configured correctly so you don't lose anything. But it's just very important to remember, there's no redos with Google Analytics. So the very first step to getting started with Google Analytics is actually understanding the structure of your account. And then we'll go in through to installing, configuring, and getting through tracking links and all of the reports and what you should and should not be focused on. So when it comes to your account structure, you have an account at the very top, and this is what's going to be actually connected to your Gmail or G Suite for Business address. You can have access to multiple accounts, multiple websites, and you can add people at this level. We'll get to who should and should not be added in a second. Then underneath your account, you're going to have something called properties. And properties represent your actual websites. Website plus all the subdomains. Don't make separate properties for subdomains. And then inside of each one of those properties is going to be something called views. And views is where you're going to essentially be doing a lot of your custom configurations. And you can always get to this overarching settings view by clicking the little gear icon in the bottom left of your screen from any page inside of Analytics. It is always there, so you can always come back to this page. Now, that's a brief overview of what happens at each level. So now let's take a deeper dive into specifically what actions you should be taking with each one of these. Now, you'll notice on the setting page, there are a lot of things here, but we're just going to gray out everything that does not matter when you're getting started. We're gonna 80-20 here. This is a beginner's guide. You don't need to go into all the nitty-gritty details in order to start getting some real actionable value. You could always take a deeper dive, but when you're just getting started, let's get some information so we can make some good traffic and marketing decisions as quickly as possible. So at the account level, going back to our diagram here, what you're going to be doing at your account level is adding your co-founders and anyone who is the head of your marketing team. And that is it. So pretty much people who are working directly with you, like business partners, or if you have a full stack marketer, then add them. If you're hiring freelancers, then you're actually going to want to add them at the property level. And so you can actually add people at the account, property, and view level. So if you have anyone who's running traffic for you, or maybe you have a couple virtual assistants, you can actually just add them at the view level so they can see the data, but they won't be able to mess anything up. Because remember, nothing is retroactive in analytics. If you screw something up, you're just out of luck. So you definitely want to be very, very careful with who you add and what permissions that you give them. Now, when it comes to permissions, it pretty much ranges from they can do everything to add users all the way down to they can only view things. So the less people who can make changes in your analytics, the better. Now, when it comes to your property settings, this is where you're going to be adding your individual website. So if you have one company and you have multiple websites, go ahead and add all of those websites in there. If you have multiple companies with multiple websites, then you definitely want to make sure that all of your properties are related to the same company or at least the same project. You don't want to have five or six different projects or companies inside of one account. That's just going to get way too overwhelming, and you don't want to hit the limits of the number of views and properties you can have inside of Google Analytics. And also at the property level, you're going to be able to get your tracking code, which is what we're going to do next when we install Google Analytics, and you're going to be able to connect your Google Ads and AdSense account if you have either of those, and you can connect multiple analytics to multiple Google Ads and vice versa. So if you connect something, don't feel like you're chained in and you can't change it in the future. Now, when it comes to your views, this is something where you're going to be actually just manipulating how the data is presented or what you're actually tracking. So here you're going to be setting up something called goals, content groups, and filters. And if you have subdomains, this is where you're going to set up different views so you only see the traffic that came from your individual subdomain. Now, when it comes to goals, filters, and content groups, this is really where things are not retroactive. And when we get to configure, you'll see why it's so important to actually create multiple views before you touch any of these. But typically, those three are advanced features that we're not going to need to cover when we're just getting started. We can leave those alone for now. So that's a brief overview of the three levels of your Google Analytics account and what you can and can't do or should do at each one of them. So now that you kind of have a better understanding of what's going on inside your account, let's go ahead and make sure we add the tag to your site. Now, if you already have the tracking code on your site, you can go ahead and skip to configuration. Here's the timestamp for the configuration. Here, we're just gonna go through the install. So when it comes to installing, you first, of course, need to create a property, right? You need to set up your website. So presumably, you already have an account set up. So you go to the bottom left, you go ahead and click on settings, and so that you get to this particular page, and then you click on new property. Once you get to the new property page, all you need to do is go ahead and give an internal name for the property. So this isn't ever going to be public. So just an internal naming convention so you know what site it is. Then you'd go ahead and put the actual URL, not the subdomain, the top level domain. It's so important that you don't start adding subdomains here. And then you'll go ahead and add some additional information. Google will ask you about your industry. You'll find that these are very broad and it's not at all important. It's just to help you with benchmarks if you decide to use it. And typically, I just don't recommend using benchmarks because the categories are so broad, it's almost never actually useful. And then you'll go ahead and make sure you have the correct time zone. And if you're doing this for another business or client, make sure that it's in their time zone, the actual business's time zone, not necessarily the time zone you're currently in. So you might want to change that, especially if you're traveling while you're setting this up. And then you go ahead and click Get Tracking ID. You'll be taken to this page where you'll be given your UA code. Now, before we get into your UA code and your tracking information, if for whatever reason you accidentally click out of this, you go, oh no, where do I get my UA code? Well, if you go back to the settings page, all you have to do is click on property settings, make sure you've selected the right website, and then this page will pop up again. Now, the UA code is what you'd copy and paste using some into either your website builder. Some website builders will just ask for this. You paste that into your backend interface and your page builder, and then you're good to go. You don't have to worry about any code in the header or body or footer tag things. If you're using Google Tag Manager, which I highly recommend, link in the description to a full course on how to use Google Tag Manager. Simply, Google Tag Manager is just like a file cabinet for all the tracking that you have to put on your website. It makes it very, very easy to add multiple tracking codes, especially if you're doing Google Ads and YouTube Ads, Facebook Ads. All the tracking codes can go inside of Tag Manager, but essentially this is the code that you need if you're not pasting the code directly onto your site. Now, if you're doing something on WordPress, then you're probably actually just going to need the code. And for that, you can just go ahead and click on the left-hand side and you'll be able to get the tracking code. And this tracking code is what you need to place in the header tag of your entire site. So when you're installing Google Analytics, it's very important that it goes on every single page, like literally every single page. There's no special pages where it shouldn't or shouldn't go. It just goes everywhere. It's nice and simple, much easier than trying to set up something like conversion tracking. And so inside of WordPress, or if you're using a page builder, you want to look for your, in your settings or dashboard, something like analytics, tracking, or scripts, and navigate to where they give you the option to edit your body tag, your header tag, and your footer tag. You want to take the analytics code, not just that ID, but the whole code, and put it in your header tag. And when you click save, your software or plugin or theme should automatically put it across your entire site. If you're using WordPress, link in the description to a video that walks you through a free plugin you can use in order to put it across your site if your theme or current page builders doesn't allow you to do this. Now, specifically on WordPress, if you have a theme for your main site and you're using a page builder like Thrive Themes or OptimizePress, then you actually do need to make sure that you add it twice, because not all themes will put it on your page build sites. So here's another example. Inside of the Thrive dashboard, you'd click on scripts and then you'd go ahead and get this nice little pop-up where you can select header, footer, or body tag. You'd select header tag and then just paste the code in there. Two more examples to go. I'm just trying to cover as many as possible. Inside of OptimizePress, the old version, you'd go to your dashboard, analytics and tracking, and then go ahead and paste it in the header tag. So hopefully one of these three examples is close to what your page builder looks like or what your theme looks like. This is what you want to look for in order to paste that code. And if you're using Shopify, it's really simple. You just copy paste that UA code and paste it in the box where it says Google Analytics, and you're all set up and good to go. So now that you've installed it, we want to make sure that it's actually working. So go over to Google and just do a quick search for Chrome Web Store Tag Assistant. And this is a free Chrome plugin, so you do have to be using Google Chrome, that will actually ensure that the tag is on your site. Because it's one thing to go into your site and click save and go, okay, yeah, it's there. And you go, well, is it actually there though? How do I know? Well, this is how you will know. So you can go ahead, just add this. It's developed by Google themselves. There'll be a little pop-up after download with all, just leave all those boxes checked. Go ahead and click to install it, and then go to your website. And you'll notice, you'll go to your website and you click on the little icon in the top right, and you'll see that nothing shows up, and you'll actually have to click enable and then refresh the page, and then it will start showing your tag. So if your tag is green, means you're good to go. If your tag is blue, means you're pretty much good to go. If your tag is red, that means there might be a problem. So you'd want to click through, and then it'll give you a bunch of code that makes no sense. Just copy and paste it into Google, and someone has already figured out why it may or may not be working. In this particular example, it's red because I actively use blockers to block the tracking because I don't want to mess up our clients' tracking. So if you're doing any sort of digital marketing for your company, then you definitely want to look into blocking yourself from Google Analytics and all your tracking so you don't mess up your statistics, because that has been something I've seen in the past with small businesses where we think we're getting a bunch of visits, but it's actually just the employees who are checking the site or logging into the back end to fix things. So you definitely don't want to mess up your analytics data. And that is all there is to it, to installing Google Analytics. So once it's installed on your site, you've used the tag checker to make sure that it's on your site in Chrome, you're ready to configure. Now, when it comes to configuring your Google Analytics, most of what you can do here is advanced, and it's not something you need to do in your first go at analytics. So link in the description to the longer tutorial that will walk you through setting up goals and things to track your different content and setting up filters here. You don't need to worry about that. What you do need to worry about, though, is the fact that we're not retroactive. So we want to hit a giant save button on everything that we've done so far right now, before we touch anything else. Well, almost before we touch anything else, but pretty much before we touch anything else, we want to make sure that we save something called a master view. And so you're going to be in your account, you're going to select the web property that you're working on, and then under views, you're going to click create new, and you're going to name this new view master view, and then you're never going to touch it again. So essentially what we're doing here, if we go back to our diagram, remember that your view is essentially that little gray box that's making a bunch of changes and spitting out the data you asked for. So here what we want to do is make sure there's a view where that box pretty much does nothing, absolutely nothing. And so when you go and start playing with things, or if something winds up not working in the future, you can always go back to this master view and just duplicate it and start over again. So this is the only thing you have to do when you're first setting up your Google Analytics. You'll have all website data that you'll use for everything else, but you'll just make sure that you have this master view that's your backup that is completely untouched collecting data. Now, the only asterisk here, the only thing you need to do with your master view is actually go into your overview and navigate on the left-hand side to audience and go ahead and enable demographics. That is the only thing you want to do. Just click that button, enable demographics, and then never touch master view again. So it's almost a hard save, but you do want to make sure that you enable demographics because that's definitely not retroactive. So with our also website data, we are ready to start looking at what reports and what kinds of things we can take a deeper dive into to figure out whether or not there are areas to improve our website or content or traffic campaigns. But in order to do that, we need to tell Google Analytics where everyone is coming from. Because while it's great to have all that data on what's actually going on the site, we also want to know where people came from. And so before we jump into the reporting, analyzing data, we need to talk about link tracking. Now, chances are you've probably clicked a link before and then you've looked in the URL and you've seen this crazy long text and you're like, what is all that stuff? Well, that is something called UTM parameters. So when you create links for social, for your advertising, for any your emails, any place else, what you can do is you can actually add information to the end of your URL to tell Google Analytics things like where the traffic came from, what campaign it was, what email was it, what specific video or ad was it. So you can get really, really detailed here. So this is an example of what a UTM URL might look like. And at first glance, you go, what on earth is going on there? But when we color code it, you can see that there are four distinct pieces of information. We have source, medium, campaign, and content. So source being YouTube is where's the traffic coming from? Medium is what type of traffic is it? Is it organic? Did we pay for it? Is it referral? Is it affiliate? And then we have a campaign name, and then we have content, which is essentially going to be the blog post or video or Facebook post someone came from, or it will be your specific ad name inside of your Facebook, Google, Instagram, Pinterest, whatever ad, LinkedIn, whatever ads you're running. So when it comes to how you should name these, number one, they need to be all lowercase all the time. Everything in Google Analytics should just be lowercase, because if you change the case, like let's say for example here, you're looking at AN-general. Well, if I capitalize that AN, Google Analytics is going to think that's a completely different campaign, and then it's just going to split the traffic between two different campaigns. And when we're trying to analyze, we go, okay, great. Now I have to download it in Excel and put them together. And then it's just a mess. Make sure everything is undercase and you name everything the exact same. Here's a quick rundown of what you could use for staying organized with your URLs. Remember, timestamp table of contents to come back to this diagram. So under campaign source, this is required. You'd say something like Google, YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, essentially, where did the traffic come from? Then medium, you could say CPC, a banner ad, maybe it was from a newsletter, it's an organic, it's an affiliate or referral. And then next you'd campaign name. This would essentially be what's the name of the actual campaign. And this is where you decide, right? So if you're running Facebook or YouTube ads, then it could be the actual specific campaign name. Or you could just say, you know what, I have this particular offer and any traffic that is driving to this particular page or trying to sell this could be that campaign, right? So later on when we're doing analysis, you'll see that that's actually how we organize our content campaigns. Next, we have campaign term, and this is really only gonna be used if you are doing some advanced things inside of your Google Ads. So that will be taken care of inside of your Google Ads automatically. We don't have to worry about it right now. Now, finally, when it comes to giving your ad a name, this doesn't necessarily have to be advertising. So if you're not running paid advertising, what you can do is you can come up with codes or names for your content. So if you have a particular blog post that's sending people to a landing page or a sales page, then you can go ahead and give that blog post a code or a name. Same thing if you're doing YouTube videos or if you're doing Facebook posts. Obviously Instagram, you only have the link in the bio unless you're running ads, so you don't have to worry about it there. And you'll see later on when we're analyzing how you can actually apply the campaign and the content code to easily see exactly what piece of content is driving you the most traffic or conversions. And that is all there is to it, to the breakdown of the URL. Now, do you need to type this out every time you want to create a URL? Of course not. Google has your back when it comes to a free tool. So all you have to do is go to Google, just type in UTM Builder. The first result is going to be a free tool from Google where you literally just fill in the blanks for the URL you want to create, and then Google will automatically give you the tracking link. You copy and paste that into your blog post, your Facebook post, whatever you're doing. And then now every time someone clicks that link, all that information is going to be sent over to Google Analytics, and you're going to have next level tracking. It is one of the most powerful things you can do with Google Analytics, and it is really the first step to actually having Google Analytics go from something that's, oh, that's nice data, to, oh my gosh, this is such pure gold. Like, this is really, I can't stress enough how important this particular step is. And that's why we skipped all that other configuration stuff, because that doesn't matter if we're not meticulously tracking all of this traffic that's coming to our site. Now, we've gone through how to install it on our site. We've configured and hit that giant save button, so we have our master view, so we can pretty much go to town learning how to use analytics without messing anything up. And now we just covered how to actually make sure that we know exactly where traffic is coming from. So now that we have all of that, we're ready to actually start analyzing. So let's take that, all of that data, and turn it into actionable information. And to do that, we only need to answer three questions and use a couple of reports to start extracting some value out of Google Analytics right now. And the three questions are, who are your customers? Where are they coming from? And how do you get more? So for your audience, we're going to be looking at age, gender, location, and then something called affinity and in-market audiences. So in your main dashboard, we're not in our settings, we've gone to overview now. You are going to be looking under audience. We're going to be looking at three separate places. We're going to look at demographics, interests, and geo. So let's go ahead and start with demographics. Demographics, you just have to click the overview and it's going to tell you the approximate age and gender of people who are visiting your site. And that's all that you really need to look at here. You can play with the date ranges and do some comparisons to see how this data has changed over time. But essentially, that's all you need. You want to know what general age your customer or site visitors are, and then what general genders they are. So the next one we want to look at is interests. And interests is interesting because Google actually makes something called affinity in market. They also have topic audiences, but we won't get into that here. So what you're looking at here are groups of people that Google has created. Now, very simply put, affinity is pretty much hobbyists and people who are actively interested in a particular topic or have shown a behavior over an extended period of time. Whereas in market is more of those people who are actively looking to buy. So in market is where Google's trying to say, these people are probably going to purchase something around this particular topic, product, or service very soon. Whereas affinity is, these people generally seem to be interested in it and they probably have a hobby or an extended interest. So if you're doing any sort of YouTube advertising or Google advertising, then this first one, affinity, is going to be very helpful. If you're doing any sort of Google search or display, then this in-market audience is going to be very helpful in terms of trying it out inside of your ads account. And if you're not doing anything with Google Ads, then this probably isn't going to be too helpful, especially because, as you can see the percentages here, unless you're in a very, very niche place or you have a website that is pretty much completely aligned with one of these audiences, you're going to find the overall percentage of people who fall into one of these categories is pretty low. I mean, 3 or 6% of total traffic for this website falling into one of these categories isn't all that helpful in terms of choosing what audiences might really be good for advertising, but it is a good place to keep an eye on. Now, finally, we have location, and location is going to be very helpful if you're a local-based business. So if you are doing any sort of local advertising or marketing, this is going to be really, really cool, and it's going to be really creepy once you realize how much information people have on us when we're going around just browsing the internet. So of course, you have a map overview, and you can scroll down and see the countries, but also on the map, what you can do is you can click through to a specific country, and then you can actually start clicking through territories and states, and you can go all the way down to the city level. So taking a look at a live example here, you can see for this particular site, Most people have come from the US, only 4 people from Mongolia. So let's go ahead and click on the US and take a look at which states are getting the most traffic for this particular site. And no surprise, the usual suspects: California, Texas, Florida, and this is going to be New York. Now, if I wanted to take a deeper dive and really understand where these 1,500 people were from California, I can go ahead and click and zero in even more, and all of a sudden I can start mousing over and seeing the individual cities in California and zoom in here, 105 from San Francisco, a 20 from Alameda, and this is as creepy as it looks. I mean, I'm literally seeing exactly where people are located when they are visiting this particular site. So if you are doing any sort of local-based advertising, this is really going to be powerful in helping you figure out where you should be targeting your ads. Now, when it comes to acquisition and where people are coming from, the good news is even if you haven't set up any UTM parameters yet and given all Google Analytics all that extra juicy data, Google Analytics does a somewhat barely decent job of figuring out where people come from, even if you're not using UTM. So what you would do here is we're actually going to look at all traffic data, and then we're going to be taking a look at source and medium, just so I can illustrate how powerful UTM parameters can be once they start working in your favor. So first, let's just go ahead and go to all traffic. And here it's going to break down the different types of traffic that are coming to your site. So under channels here, you can see our organic traffic, our social traffic, referral traffic, direct traffic. Now, a keynote on quick insight on direct traffic. Direct traffic is analytics' way of saying, we don't know where they came from. So you don't want a high direct traffic number. It might at first glance be like, oh yeah, people are going straight to my site. No, that's not what's happening. That's where Google Analytics goes, we don't know where they came from. So we're just gonna put them over here. So UTM parameters are going to help lower that direct traffic number, but you definitely want that to be as low as possible. I mean, the ultimate goal would be zero, but you know, I'm probably not going to be able to track literally every single person who visits your site. So the goal should just be getting direct traffic as low as possible. Now, something you can do on this page, other than just generally seeing some statistics, is actually going up and adding something called a secondary dimension. So you click on the little secondary dimension drop-down menu, and you're going to click on source and medium. Now, this is going to be a little redundant compared to what we'll do next in the acquisition, but this will just be helpful, especially if you're not doing UTM parameters. This is pretty much as far as you need to go. And then it's going to start telling you the type of traffic and source. So if it's organic, did it come from Google? Did it come from Bing? Is the Google traffic organic? Is the Google traffic paid? Is the Bing traffic paid? Is the Bing traffic organic? Same for Facebook and other social media sites. And so it just gives you a wider breakdown of specifically what's being put into those broad categories. Now, if you have a lot of if you don't have a lot of traffic, like this particular account, then this is as far as you need to go. But if you have a lot of traffic, or you've already started playing with your UTM links, then you're actually going to want to click on source medium on the left-hand side, so that source medium becomes the default. And the reason you'd want to do this is because when source medium comes to the default, you can go ahead and click on secondary dimensions, and then you can start looking at things like your campaigns and your ad creatives. It just gives you a little bit more flexibility. So if that sounds like fun, then go ahead and do it. If that sounds just like more work or redundant, then just skip it and stick with the channels. Now, the final one we want to talk about, little bonus here, is going down to campaigns under acquisition. And this is only going to work if you're already doing UTM parameters, but I just want to show you why UTM parameters are so important. So when you set up UTM parameters, you remember in our URL, we had a place to say campaign, and we had a place to essentially give the ad creative a code. Well, something that we can do here is when we click on campaigns, you'll see all of these campaigns have been set up using a UTM parameter. They didn't exist until we put them in a URL. So now we are able to see all of the traffic for each one of our offers. So on this particular YouTube channel, every once in a while, I offer something for free in our free memberships website, the Aspire Notebook. And so instead of just linking it in the description, there's a UTM parameter link in the description that says what the lead magnet is or what the free offer is, and then also says what specific video. So if we go to secondary dimension again, and we click on advertising and ad creative, all of a sudden, we're actually able to see the specific video that drove those people to the website or the landing page. And I can't stress enough how powerful this is. I mean, just look at this data. This is telling me that whatever M15 is really, really good at driving new people to the website compared to something like B41 that's only driven 96 people. And so you can actually start getting some insight as to which blog posts or pieces of content that you're putting out actually drive action to your website, actually bring people over to your site. Now, the final question we have is how do we get more? And this is the most complicated one. At this point, we know, have a general understanding of where people are from and who they are and their interests or what they're specifically looking to buy via in-market audiences. And you've seen the power of UTM parameters once they start working so you can actually optimize your ads or your content. Now it's time to say, okay, what is actually driving people to take action on our site? And this is something advanced called conversions. And so I've gone over to another view of this same property. So now you can see here that there's actually a drop-down menu in the conversion section where I can choose something called goals. And goals is something that's part of the configuration process that's advanced. And so if you want to start meticulously tracking how many people enter their name and email on a certain page, or how many people buy a certain product or purchase or go through and fill out a certain form to get on the phone with you, this is where you're actually going to start setting up goals. And this is the next step. This is the beginning of intermediate. So everything we've covered so far, beginner, you're good to go. You can actually start using Google Analytics, and your primary goal is to get UTM parameters across everything that you do. That should be priority number one, even before you set up goals, is just knowing where's traffic coming from, getting all your traffic organized and categorized. Now, when it comes to setting up goals, there are a lot of different ways you could do it. It would be twice as long as this video so far. So all you have to do is click on conversions on the left-hand side, and you'll get this pop-up that essentially says, hey, you haven't set up any goals yet. So you can go ahead and click on set up goals, and Google will actually start to guide you through setting up your first round of goals. And I highly recommend using Google Tag Manager in conjunction with analytics so that setting up your goals is a breeze. So thank you so much for watching. I sincerely hope you got some value out of this video, and you just saw the tiny picture of everything that you could do with Google Analytics. So I sincerely hope it wasn't too overwhelming. I know feedback on the last video was it was way, way too long, and there was too much advanced stuff in there. So hopefully this one was a good overview and had enough little advanced things that you have plenty to do, and just shows you the power that you have with this free tool, Google Analytics. So go ahead and hit that like button and subscribe for more in-depth marketing tutorials and strategy guides just like this one. Comment below with your Google Analytics questions, and until the next, keep building the business you love.